Okay, Lenisha, go ahead.
All right. So, a very good afternoon to everyone and all the participants. So, we meet again in another episode of Nature Hero Talks 3.0. So, today's topic would be biodiversity in the Straits of Malacca. And this is presented by Maria. Okay, so this talk is brought to you by NS Malacca Branch. We are a voice for nature. And if you wish to be part of it, you can join us by getting an MNS membership through this link below. So family would be 80 ringgit and subsequently it'd be 70 ringgit. And then youth will be 15 ringgit at first and 10 ringgit subsequently. And Club Pencipta Alam for schools will be 50 ringgit per year. If you don't have a Club Pencipta Alam in school, you may contact us and we will discuss with your teacher to set up one. Okay, so we are not alone. We are a network of 14 branches across Malaysia. So we all are aiming to be part of a stronger voice for nature. So join us in this. And just a moment. There's a technical issue. I can't move into the next slide. Okay.
So you can unshare and then share again.
Okay. I think the slide is working now. Thank you. Okay. So the object, sorry for the interruption. The objective of this talk would be first to provide basic understanding of the environment around us, the stars, earth, plants, and animals, and how we can take care of them. And second objective would be to encourage more students to take science stream, particularly conservation and environmental courses. So after the talk ends, there will be a few activities. First would be nature guide, and another one would be regular camping at Tanjung Tuan PD. So this talk can be accessed through the ecopartners.online app. And the main benefit that you can get from this app would be students will be able to earn extracurricular activities. So don't miss out on this. And about the talk will last approximately 30 minutes. And this will be followed by a 10-minute Q&A session. So if you have any inquiries or questions, please get it into the chat box or at the live page. And the quiz, as you know, it will happen at the same time as the Q&A session. So once you are submitted the quiz, the fastest top 5 will win prizes and e-certificates will be distributed to students who have scored more than 70% in the quiz, okay, via the app. So next, okay. As you can see, there are two types of certificates. First would be the normal certificate and prizes. So these certificates can be obtained on every talk session, which will be held every 2 weeks. So the quiz, if you get a 70% passing mark, you will get a certificate issued by the MNS NS Malacca branch. And the top 5 prizes will be given to those with the highest mark and also the fastest to answer the quiz questions within the 10 minutes. And also, you have to complete the follow-up action. You'll be given 50 eco points if you complete the follow-up actions. And the second certificate would be recognized by the Ministry of Education. So you are required to attend a 2-hour forum, which will be held on 30th of October to discuss and refresh all the topics learned, followed by a 50 quiz questions. Okay. So 80% of the quiz questions will be from the talk already covered, which will be from 12 June to 16th October. And 20% will be taken from the day's discussion, which is on the 30th of October. So you will be given 24 hours to complete the quiz after the event, okay? So the certificate recognized by the Ministry of Education will be given. So top 5 will receive the competition and achievement certificate, while the rest will be given the CGL Penyerahan or the participation certificate. So students, don't miss out on this opportunity and start watching or attending recorded videos on the topic covered from 12 June. And then do the quiz and the follow-up actions as well if you want to receive certificates. Okay, so you can register now inside the app itself. So what you have to do is there'll be an event known as SDGs, What Can We Do? Click on that event and you can click to attend and participate. And this poster is designed by our committee member. So you can have a look here if you have any doubts. Okay, so if you're wondering where do you want to where can you get your e-certificate? So you can get it in the app itself. So for normal certificate, the link will be attached below the event that you've attended if you get 70% and above for your quiz, okay? And then there'll be another certificate given, which is certified by the Ministry of Education. So that will be, the link will be attached below the event after 30th of October, after you've done your quiz and after you attended the event, okay? So the sponsors for today's quiz prizes would be Turtle Conservation Society, Dominic O'Sullivan, Salute and MNS Penang. Thank you so much for these lovely gifts. Okay, so so if you wish to receive the latest updates from MNS, do like our Facebook page and also subscribe to our YouTube channel. And the link will be attached at the comment box. My co-host will be attaching it to the comment box, so you don't have to rush in to scan the QR code. Okay, these are the schedule for the environmental literacy talks, and we have come a very long way, and now we are at the end, almost at the end. And today would be Life Below Water by Maria. Okay, so before that, is your best friend's birthday coming up, or any special event that's coming up, or you wish to give something special to your loved ones? Why not give a gift of life? Plant a mangrove for them and send an e-card. This is a great initiative by Replant for You. And let me guide you to the app. You can actually get this to the app itself. You can do it all through this app. So the first thing you can do is you can click on the promotions icon here. And then you'll be led to this page, Replant for You Mangrove Restoration Campaign. Click on this and there'll be four buttons here. Click on the sponsor button. And this will appear on the app. So you have to quantify how many saplings you would like to buy. So for students, it would be 25 ringgit per sampling. And for adults, it would be 40 ringgit per sampling. So once you have clicked your desired amount of sapling, you can upload your payment here. Just a minute. You can upload your payment here. And the details, the payment details will be located here. So you don't have to worry. And then now you can also name your tree. It could be anything. It's optional also. And you can also send an e-gift card to your loved ones or your best friend. And then you can also choose card and also email them. Okay? Just a moment. My slide freezed again. Just a moment. Okay. Sorry about that. So now I'm going to introduce our speaker of the day. She's going to talk about biodiversity in the Strait of Malacca. She's a Canary Island born from Spain and an ocean lover. She moved to Malaysia in 2015 to work as the general manager at Salut in Malacca. She's also a marine biologist and worked as an exhibition host for 8 years in the National Park of the Atlantic Islands of Galicia, and has participated in many environmental programs in collaboration with the Spanish government. Not only that, she has her own website known as Milas by Orillas, so go check it out. And she's a passionate wildlife conservation photojournalist, where she aims to bring the ocean to those who do not explore it themselves through aquatic art. She's also the co-founder of Sungai Project, an organization to create a community that respects wildlife and the Malacca Sea. So without further ado, let me invite Maria Marcos Vicente to present her speech for today.
Thank you, Linisa. I share the screen. Let me share the screen here. Here you are. You can see? Yeah?
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Okay. First of all, thanks so much to all the attendees for being here today. Thanks so much to Malaysia Nature Society, especially the brands Negari Milan Malacca, for the wonderful job that you are doing with this kind of nature Eero talks. Okay, and thanks so much to all these people that make that is behind the screen and make that this is possible. Okay, As Linisa already mentioned, and I think you already realize, I'm not Malaysia, I come from Spain, but I live here already 6 years in Melaka, okay? So this is another perspective about the coastline of Melaka, because sometimes we need that someone come from outside, make us realize how rich is the land that we live in, okay? So my mission today is remind you how special is this land that you live in, how privileged you are, okay? As well to show you the current threats, like the habitat loss and the plastic pollution, okay? So how important is, I want you realize, if we don't look after properly, this ecosystem could be lost forever, okay? I want to do also a small introduction about myself. My name is Maria Marcos, I'm marine biologist, and I specialize in conservation and management of natural areas. There in Spain, I worked in a national park. I worked for the Spanish government in the environment department. When I came here to Malaysia, in Melaka, I work as a general manager of Salud Tapas. And also I participate in some programs, the coral conservation in the east coast of Malaysia. So all my life I was involved in the environment awareness. For that I create my own website in 2012. The name is Millas y Orillas, this is in Spanish, but the translation is here, the miles and the seashores, okay, miles and seashores. And I write there articles about the nature, and I also do underwater photo exhibition, because I realize no everyone have the opportunity to dive. So I want to make close this underwater world to everyone. So I also write for another website, quite famous there in Spain. It's a travel website. The name is Comochila. And we also do some podcasts, okay? And here in Melaka, I'm preparing trips to see the Melaka turtles in the Pantai Padangke Mountain, and also to visit the Sungai Linggi, the river. And as Linisa already mentioned, I'm the co-founder with another two beautiful souls. We are three persons. We create Sungai Project, that our mission is reconnect the people with themselves, with others and the nature, and we organize a beach cleanup. So I hope you can join us. Okay, so Buti from Malaysian Nature Society, he invited me to talk about the biodiversity of the coastline of Melaka. So I would like to start my presentation telling you that Melaka, appreciate what you have before it become in what you have, okay? Everybody, I mean, worldwide, know Melaka as historical city, but maybe what not everyone knows, or maybe don't acknowledge, even the local people don't know, is all the hiding life that you can found here, okay? And not only the different species, if not only the connection and the interaction between them. So this makes this state even more special, okay? So along the Strait of Malacca, you can find one of the most important biodiversity hotspot on the planet. Okay, I stop and I repeat these sentences, okay? One of the most important biodiversity hotspot on the planet. This is because in this region, bring hundreds of different species. It's like a strategic point, not only for the marine traffic, human marine traffic, I mean the shipping, the boats, no, that cross here and join Asia with the west part of the world. Also, it's important for the wildlife, okay, because it's a strategic point. And In this region, you can find even species that you cannot find in another place of the world. So I want you to see how important is the Strait of Malacca, okay? So when I talk about the biodiversity, I talk about the different number or the different variety of the species. I mean different plants, different animals, okay? So all of these together create the biodiversity. When I talk about the ecosystem, I talk about these living parts, I mean the plants, the animal, or the microorganisms, okay? But as well, I talk about the non-living parts, that is the weather, the landscape, the rock, the water, the sand, the air, these non-living parts, okay? So all together create like a bubble of life, okay? And this is what we call ecosystem. And for that, it's super interesting not only know about the species, if not know about the interaction, okay, between all the species, okay? So for that, I always say this sentence, the more that we learn about the nature, the more that we want to protect it, okay? So when we talk about the coastal ecosystem, there is one sentence that I like so much, it's quite romantic, because they say it's where the land meets the sea, okay? So all this line can create different kind of ecosystem. Inside this ecosystem can be another ecosystem. I mean, an ecosystem can be so large as a forest, okay? And so small as a tree or a drop of water or the pool that create the lowest tide. When the tide go down, you know, sometimes create a pool on the rock, right? But this also is a kind of micro ecosystem. So it's super interesting to study. Okay, so we can divide the coastal ecosystem as mangroves, the seagrass bed, the lagoons, the black water. Okay, they are different. But here in Melaka, we have four main ecosystems, okay? Four main marine ecosystems. And I will talk about each one, and also I will introduce one of the species that use this ecosystem, okay, for you remind, okay? For you remember forever. So the four ecosystem is the sandy beach, okay? The mangrove, okay? The seagrass bed, and the rocky shore. Four marine ecosystem. So we start with the sandy beach. I mentioned before I come from Spain. In Spain, we, especially in summer, we like to make the life under the sun. We like to use the beach, you know, and make life there, no, under the sun. But when I came to Malaysia, I realized in Malaysia, we cannot use the beach as we do in Spain, because the weather is so hot, no, it's heated. You cannot be under the sun here. So this not only happened to us, to humans, also happened to many animals. They have to adaptate. Because the conditions are quite extremely, okay? So some of them, they live burrowing under the sun, okay? Or some of them that just use this ecosystem for nests. For example, is the case of the turtle. I'm pretty sure you know you are a lucky country, okay? Malaysia is super lucky country because you have the lucky to be chosen for 6 turtles of the 7 marine turtles that got in the planet, okay? And 4 of them come to the peninsula of Malaysia, and one of these 4 turtles, the Harbil turtle, have chosen Melaka beaches, all the coastline of the Strait of Malacca, sorry, not only Malacca, the Strait of Malacca. They chosen these beaches for camp and nest laying the eggs, okay? So this is quite privileged, no? I think you have to feel proud for to have this such a species on your beach, okay? And I feel you have to work together for the conservation of this starter. For don't happen the same like happened in Terengganu, I put in red color, you see I put the leatherback turtle in red color because before always come to the Terengganu coastline, but already the report is long time didn't come, so they start to consider as extinct. So you don't want this happen to you. So we have to protect the places, the ecosystem that they come to nest. Okay, so don't let disappear the Melaka beaches, okay? They are quite special. They travel hundreds and thousands of kilometers between these and the places where they make up. And I think you have to feel proud because they choose your coastline, okay? So another ecosystem, the second one, I have to say, I really amazed, for me, really amazing to visit the mangrove. I don't know, maybe it's because in Spain we don't have mangroves. So I think you are so lucky to have this kind of ecosystem so near you. Bueno, it's all around the coastline of Malaysia, but here, especially in Melaka, you have so near. The other day, Dr. Swan, thank you so much for the presentation he did, because was I learned a lot. I feel always from the mangroves you cannot stop to learn because there's so huge biodiversity that you always have something to learn new, okay? Because they are from large animals to the zooplankton, that is the micro life in the water. So you have a huge range to learn. This is create a special habitat for nesting, for breeding, or just for migration. So you have to protect this kind of ecosystem. I think you are so lucky. And also because they do two functions for humans, for us, that is, first one, they are essential to keep the water quality. You know the cycle of the water, we always have the same quantity of water, but we have to be a little worried about the quality of the water. Okay, and the mangrove, they help us to like filter the water. So we have to be grateful to the mangroves. And also because they do something so important for us, like release oxygen, and also help us to fight against the climate change because they help us to absorb CO2, okay? And I really love to go to the Sungai Linggi because there you can see a lot of species. And as I mentioned before, you have the fortune to have mangrove, but I want to tell you something. Your mangrove is quite high diverse. They are one of the most high diverse in the world. So as I mentioned before, you have to feel proud. Also, you have this species I really love. I fall in love with the saltwater crocodile. This photo I took in Sungai Linggi, and they are the largest reptile on the world. I'm a super fan of reptiles, maybe for that I love them so much. But I really impressed when I saw them because they are a living fossil. They have been here before even the dinosaurs. So you imagine how important are them. And also they have hardly changed since them. So this means they are quite perfect. Okay, so the most important to know is that here in Sungai Linggi, they are quite peaceful crocodiles. I mean, they are in the area, and I ask the fishermen and I ask everyone around, and they always tell me don't have any conflict between the crocodiles and the humans. So this is a sample to give to the world because you can coexist humans and this species that can be our apex, no? It can we can have problems with them, but no, they respect us because we respect them. So I mean, if we disturbing the areas, we can have a big problem because they will start to looking for food for the kampungs around or the villages around. Okay. So this happened, for example, in Sabah and Sarawak, when they suffer the problem of the logging, and they have to, because they lose their own habitat, so they have to looking around for food and place for sleep. It's logic, okay? So, Melaka, if you don't want that happen this to you, I think you have to respect the area. And it's very easy to find them in the Sungai Linggi. So just respect this kind of habitat, okay? Then the next marine ecosystem you can find here in the Strait of Malacca is the rocky shore. I really love also to come around these areas, especially in the low tide, when you can see in the pools that I mentioned before, the pools that create the lowest tide, you can find a micro ecosystem that you can see the seaweed and the animals that eat the seaweed and the animals that eat the animals that eat the seaweed. So it's quite interesting. You can see a documentary just in a pool of water. So it's super interesting. And also when you discover that these kind of animals, they are adapted themselves to this kind of fluctuation of the salt water and the salinity and this kind of thing, okay? So it's quite interesting to study that. And I want to mention one of my favorite sea life. I cannot choose only one. I have many, but this is one of my favorite, is the corals. Is the corals. They're so beautiful. For that one that don't know what is a coral, the corals are related with the jellyfish and the anemones. I like to say they are like the ocean flowers or the flowers of the ocean, okay? Because they look like a flowers, right? But they are an animals, okay? And they, if you see the photo, they are like a lot of tentacles and a mouse, a simple mouse in the middle, okay? And they are also considered as a limnophysid because they have been here in the ocean more than 200 million of years. So we have to feel proud of being around us. It's also, if when you see a marine map of the Strait of Malacca, you can see certain areas that is considered a coral reef. When there are many, many corals, we call coral reefs, okay? So it's true that here the water now is so crystal clear as the east coast of Malaysia. So you cannot enjoy the colors and the shapes of the reefs of the corals as you can do in the east coast of Malaysia. But here, Melaka, you also have coral reefs. Okay, and they are super important because they do some functions for not only for the ocean, also for us. Okay, as the mangroves do, they also release oxygen and absorb CO2. So they are important for fight against the climate change. Okay. And then also I always say they are like the street food of the ocean because many, many species go there to just makan, okay? And also they create habitat for many marine species, okay? I want to mention also this one because for me, well, maybe because I'm biologist and to me catch my attention, no? But this one is the sea pen coral. Maybe you see when you yalan on the beach, you can see like this. This already is dry, dry for this. And you see like this, and you can see on the left, okay? And they create this kind of forest in the sandy bottom of the sea. The most interesting to know is they create bioluminescence. So I mean, you imagine how is the underwater world at night in the Melaka coastline, but nobody record it. So we just think that in Melaka, see, don't have nothing, but got a lot of the interesting life, okay? And yeah, the water not so clear here. This is in the area of Port Dickson. You can see how many corals have around us, okay? The next marine ecosystem in the coastline of Strait of Malacca is the seagrass bed, okay? The seagrass bed. For that one that don't know what is a seagrass bed, is like the photo that you see here on the screen. Look like a grass, yeah, but it's underwater. The interesting thing to know is they are like a flowering plant. It's a flowering plant, but they carry out the entire life cycle underwater, okay? And it's super important to know that they create a habitat that is using for many animals as a nursery, okay? So it's like they are the kindergarten and the schools of the marine life, okay? So if we destroy this kind of ecosystem, is like we're destroying the schools of the humans or the kindergarten places, no? So it's quite no good, right? Because no future for the next generations, right? So we have to protect this area. And also Malaysia, you are so lucky because you have 14 species of seagrass bed, okay? And a total in all the peninsula, I mean, a total recording of 20. You know, this make consider Malaysia as the most diverse seagrass in the world. I want you understand what is this, okay? Because for example, in Spain, we have only four kind of seagrass bed, and it's only in the Mediterranean Sea, and they are almost facing extinction. So please take care of these kind of areas because it's quite important. And one of the animals that really they choose this kind of ecosystem as their favorite one is the seahorses. So Melaka also has seahorses, okay? Yeah. I want to mention, okay, I want to say that here, the coastline of Melaka is a strategy point, as I mentioned before, but because join Asia with the West area, so also join different oceans. And for that is a transit a cross-by for many marine mammals. And there are a lack of information in this issue because there are very little studios. So here the researchers or the scientific still have a work to do, okay? When I talk about marine mammals, I talk about the whales, the dolphins, the porpoise, the dugongs, okay? These big and magnificent animals. There are a total record of 11 species in all Malaysia, but recording here in the Strait of Malacca, that they cross by, okay? There are a total of 9 species, okay? And I have to say that three of them, they choosing this Strait of Malacca as a resident area, okay? So we have the Indo-Pacific humpback dolphin. This we call the pink color dolphin. I don't know if you remember 2 months ago or something like it, someone found in the Pantai Puteri, the one pink color dolphin already dead, but this means they are around, okay? And then Also for that time, I don't know, 1 week before or after, was viral also one video that a fisherman recording playing the irrawaddy dolphin, playing with the boat of the fisherman. So the irrawaddy dolphin is the smallest dolphin in the world. So you have the lucky to have this kind of species around you. So for that, you have to protect this kind of ecosystem, okay? Because it's their house, okay? And the Indo-Pacific fine-lace porpoise is this one on the photo on the top. It's similar like a dolphin, but without a fin, okay? More or less. Then I want to make a walk for the beach of Melaka. I want just destacate or remark the species that catch my attention. I can talk about all the afternoon about this, but the next season, the next Iro talk, Nature Iro talk, will be Ken from the beach school. So he has a lot of experience in the intertidal zone. So I let him explain to you better. Please join us to the next Iro talk. I just want to mention a few species that really, really catch my attention. The first one is the smooth cutter sea otter. This sea otter, well, they are super cute, okay? You can see, I think everyone can say, oh my God, so cute, right? When you see a photo, you see them in the nature. It's a magical moment, okay? And you have the lucky Melaka to have them playing around of your coastline, also playing around to the freshwater areas. I see with my eyes a few times already in the area of Pantai Kleban to Pantai Puteri, and also for the Sungai Lere. So in this area, there are a few families. So I feel you are quite lucky to have these species around because they only live in the south of Asia. And as you know, for sure, you know, for example, in Singapore, they are like, they use this species as celebrity, no? For attract the tourist people, like a paparazzi, they go there taking photos. So I think you have to protect the areas that they live in, because they come here to make their life. So I think you are quite special, Melaka. Mm. And then sometimes you don't see them, but you can see the footprints on the sand. Okay, so for that, it's interesting to. Okay. Then another species that really, really catch my attention, because I only see before on the books, on my books, okay? So I didn't see in real. So when I have the opportunity to see here in the coastline of Melaka, was like, wow. My first wow was because it's quite big. I didn't know they are quite big. And also because there are only 4 species in the world. One of them is the most studied, is the North American one. But in the south of Asia, you have 3, okay? Malacca, you have 2 in your coastline. So this made you also so special. And I have to say, they call the horseshoe crab, but they are more related to spiders and scorpions than the crabs, okay? And they are considered also a living fossil because they have been here for super long time. Here there are 2, the mangrove have the tail like round, and the coastal horseshoe crab have the tail like in triangle. This teach me Ken from school. I'm very grateful to you. He will teach you more things in the next session, so please attend. This is the trail that they live on the sand, so it's also quite interesting to see where they go, okay? Another thing that catch my attention, maybe it's because in Spain, our biggest muscle is this side. You have a muscle like this size, so it's a fan muscle. It's like, wow. And then the gorgonias is the another kind of soft coral. And then you also have different kind of crabs, very colorful crabs. The list is huge. I don't want to mention all of them, but I want to mention some, like the flower crab, because it's super colorful, or this one that is quite funny for me, maybe it's quite funny for the big eyes. Then different kind of cells. Also the list is huge. I want to remind, or I want to say you one advice. When you go on the beach and you see beautiful beautiful cells, you have to leave it on the place. Because I know sometimes we want to take as a souvenir, we want to take a free gift from the sea, but they belong to the sea, so we have to leave it on the beach, because they have more functions in the nature to still doing, okay? For example, they can create sand, they can create habitat to live, for example, the hermit crab, or even the carbonato calcicum, they can release and they can use it for another species to create the cell. So it's very important to live in on the sand, and if you want to take something, you can take what is below to us, that is the plastic, okay? Plastic is below the humans. Also, it's interesting to know for what the cells are using before. For example, this one they use as a window because it's very transparent. I think this kind of thing is quite interesting. And these two photos is the unique photos that no are mine, but I want to show you because I think it's quite, like, they look also like an alien. This is the basket starfish and also the pink sea cucumber. So you have these species. Also, I explained you already the sea otter, the macaco. The other day, you also have quite interesting talk about the dusty leaf monkey. Yeye from Penang, they also a quite inspired talk. So, and just for mention about the birds, you have the lucky to first to have the hornbill around your neighborhood. Okay, yeah. Maybe for me it's like quite amazing because they are quite big birds. You have so close, they are so beautiful. So it's like, wow. And then happen here in this coastline, a quite magical event, that is the raptor migration that you can see every March in the, especially in Port Dickson, you can see quite well. And really, for me, it was like, wow, what is going on here? Because you can see all the time like hundreds of species of eagles or another kind of raptor crossing the Strait of Malacca. So come on, you are so lucky, Malacca. You are so lucky. And this is the species that most I found usually, but not the minion. I mean the material what is creating these things is the plastic, okay? Not only in Malacca. I mean, this is around the world. We have a big problem, okay? This now is quite trending to find. The face mask and yeah, plastic bottle. So it's one of the current threats, okay? It's like a plastic pollution, and this can affect our water, land, and even our air. Okay, there are another kind of pollution, but this is quite, we have to do something. In theory, we are the intelligent species in this planet, so maybe we have to use our brain to try to stop with this problem. Now I talk a little more about this, but another current threat that I really feel is like an ecological crime. Is quite dangerous, not only for the environment, also for us, is the habitat loss. the habitat loss, okay, I understand, or everyone understand that the human population is growing, so we have to overtake natural areas. But, and we do, the humans, we do that with farming or construction, or for the farming, construction, or the land reclamation, okay? And this, as you see in the photo, is a huge problem, because you, it's like someone, for example, come today and destroy your house, okay? Where you sleep tonight, where you sleep tomorrow and the following night. You don't have place to be with your family, to sleep, or to cover when raining, or have a storm. So it's a problem, because you are destroying the house to so many species, and you are destroying the habitat of the species that I talking before. So it's a huge problem. I'm talking a little more now. And then another currently is the invasive species that sometimes the human introduce in the ecosystem, maybe intentionally or not intentionally. So this is a species, not local species, so they create conflict. It's a problem, yeah. And then another problem is the over exploitation. Human, our activities always is like overfishing, we cannot do the things a little balance. We overuse our planet, we are doing in a unsustainable way. So we have to change our way to use the planet, okay? And the other problem is the climate change, but the next season we will talk about at the end of October, we will talk about that, so I don't want to mention today nothing. About the plastic, okay, as I mentioned before, we have a huge problem. For sure, you realize there are different kinds of plastic. For the plastic have different color, different consistent, different, some ones they are more hard, others they are more soft, yeah, they are softer. So for this happen, humans, we add additive. These additives is chemicals, okay, that we add in the plastic to create a different kind of plastic, okay, for the different way that we use the plastic, okay? So international, in the international scientific world, we separate in seven different kind of plastic. For sure, you already seen the level of the plastic bottle, for example. This, you see this, the triangle, the arrow created with the triangle and the number in the middle, right? The 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The number 7 is including all these kind of plastic that no are the other 6, okay? So we have a huge problem, because not all this plastic could be recycled. The reason is the material, is the this additive, this chemical that we include in it. The most easy to recycle, or yeah, that one that can be recycled, is these two first, the number 1 and number 2, okay? And is, for example, the water plastic bottles or the detergent bottles, okay? So you know. This one is easy to recycle, but not be recycled at all. So for that, we have a huge problem, because only 9% of the plastic that we use, it, not only in Malaysia, I mean around the world, is recycled properly. The others is just accumulated in the landfill. So I think we have a big problem. And also because no, it's only the plastic that we see in the surface of the ocean, it's also the plastic that is on the bottom of the ocean, is 70% that we cannot see. And also the problem, as you know, we create the wave, the salt water and the sunlight, create the microplastic, is create different small microplastic, and the problem is introduced in our food chains. So it's a problem. So what can we do? What can we do? Stop or avoid to use plastic if you don't really need. Or try, for example, the plastic straw. This photo, this was in Cambodia, okay? But I only collect this quantity, this amount of the straw, only in 10 steps on the beach. So I want you seeing, this is a huge problem. And also because we don't really need the straw. I mean, everyone have lips, everyone have hands, we can drink like this. And if you want to use a straw, because the eyes are not bothering you, you can use alternatives. You can use the glass straw, you can use steel straw or paper straw. So only use 12 minutes. We have to stop to use a material that can be so long in our environment. Okay. For example, me now, I reduce all that I can, my plastic use. And for example, this brush, I use the bamboo, okay, created with bamboo. So I want to encourage you to try to go for a plastic-free life. Okay, try to don't buy stupid things that you don't really need or you just use for 12 minutes or 10 minutes. Okay, I think no is fair for the Mother Earth. Okay, so another kind of pollution is the ghost net, is the nest that sometimes the fishermen just left or lost on the sea, but they are still doing for what where they was created, okay, that is catching fish, okay? And here is the coastline of Melaka, because there are quite a lot of fishermen village, so we have a big, big problem with the fisher net. And another problem, the spill oil. This happened in the last year, in October, in the area of Port Dixon. I think we have to push the company, because here they are using your resource, the oil, the gas, and all the resource that the Strait of Malacca provide. But I think they have to be quite responsible and try to help when happens something like this, to help the government in the area. Because not fair, they don't do nothing. And then about the land reclamation, is they are stealing the sea. They are stealing our sea. They are stealing the sea of so many species. Just for like happening in Pulau Melaka, everybody know, right? It's like abandoned. It's just under the sand, all this ecosystem I talking you just now, all the marine species I talking you just now, just be sepulted under the sand. For create, I think everyone know that what happened in drawing, in the what the people, bueno, this kind of companies, they drawing, at the end never, become real. So they have this kind of project like, oh, super luxury city in from Melaka. I can confirm to you for my experience, this never will happen. So don't make someone cheat you, because they only are stealing your sea, okay? So this have a huge impact, no socioeconomic, because you destroy your culture, your tradition, okay? But also biological impact, because you are destroying the food chains. You are create an imbalance in the nature, and at the end, the consequence will be for us, for humans, okay? So why should we protect our ecosystem? Okay, why? I always say humans, as we have three houses. For sure you say, Maria, I only have one house. No. We have three houses. The first house is our body. For that, we have to keep our healthy, okay? The second house is our ruma, no? Our, the place where we sleep, where we maca, where we can cover when rain, okay? And the third house is our planet, is the biggest one, okay? It's our planet. For that, we have to help to grow and to thrive our ecosystem. We have to take care and try to not put in danger the animal, the plants, and at the end, ourselves, okay? Because as I mentioned before, everything is connected in the nature, okay? So I ask you, Iro talks, Iro, nature Iros, as you are, please in IOM time, yeah. I want to give you 6 advice, okay? But just not only for save the Melaka Sea, also for save our planet, our big house, okay? That we all consist here. The first one I already mentioned before is keep the plastic away, not only from the beaches, from your life. Try to keep the plastic away from your life. And how you do this, you try to use reusable products, okay? And also try this one, try to buy ocean-friendly products. I mean, when you go to buy cosmetic or sun creams, for example, try to read the ingredients, because there are a lot of ingredients, a lot of the chemicals that they are not doing well in the ocean, okay? They are affecting the marine life. So you try to look in or research about this, or if you want later, you can ask me, okay? Also, reduce your energy use. Is a small habit that do. I mean, if you are in this room, you switch off the light in the other room. So things so easy like this can help the planet a lot, okay? And of course, join to Malaysia Nature Sociality, because they are doing a wonderful job. You can learn a lot from there. They are doing a lot of activities, events, and I think it's quite interesting. All the people that join there are very beautiful soul and really worth to meet them, okay? So I encourage you to join Malaysia Nature Sociality. And here is my last advice. I want to say, learn everything you can, anytime you can, from anyone you can, because there will always come a time when you will be very grateful you did, okay? So I hope this presentation, you also learned something with me today. I hope since now you start to see the land that you live in it with another eyes. You start to interested in your ecosystem to protect them and raise the voice of the nature, because we really need people that join us in this mission. Okay, so I want to teach you one word in Spanish. Tarima casi, we say gracias. So thank you so much to be there. I also, if you want to read my articles, you can visit my website, millasyorillas.com. You can translate in English, don't worry, okay? And if you want to contact with me, I will be, you can find me by Sofia Canaris, okay? So thank you so much. I think I have time, right? Yes, on time.
Yes, thank you very much, Maria, for the amazing presentation.
I have a video. I don't know if the attendees want to see, or you have time to see, to watch.
Yeah, you can play your video.
You want to watch? Yeah?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, let me check here. I think you can see. A ver. The okay. You can see? You can what?
Nope, I can't see the video.
No, okay. Wait, sorry. A ver, I share again.
Yeah.
There is screen and I go to the video. Aha. Now?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Used to do for the videos in the YouTube channel. This is in Melaka. Now you see, bueno, this is the Komodo dragon. This is in Malaysia, all in Malaysia. Beautiful Malaysia. Is the theater where you see it real? You are so lucky, Malacca. Is the theater? Who is the doctor? The terrapin tartar. Also, you have a lot. This is a magical moment. It's super magical. Aquarium, but it's underwater. You have here. Favorite animal in the mangrove, crocodiles. Oh my God, they are amazing.
Thank you so much, Maria, for showing us how beautiful Malaysia is and the biodiversity it has. Thank you so much. So let's continue with this before the Q&A session. So this will be the follow-up action for today. So you can earn 50 eco points by doing it. So the title is What I Have Learned. So you can make a short video around 30 seconds to tell us what you have learned so far in Nature Hero Talks 3.0 and what is your favorite topic. So once you have done that, upload it to your Facebook tagging MNSN9Malacca, hashtag Nature Hero Talks, and upload the Facebook link to https ecopartners.online application. Right? So what you have to do is you just have to click on the event today, EL9 Biodiversity in the Straits of Malacca. And then below the event, you have what I have learned, and then click on that and participate in the follow-up action to earn 50 eco points. So now we will proceed with the Q&A session. So Zoe, please take it away.
Thank you, Lunisha. Thank you very much. I'm Zoe, and I'll be taking over the Q&A session for today. First of all, I would like to thank all of our participants for sticking to us to the very end of the talk. And also, most importantly, thank you, Maria, for such an inspiring and stimulating session. And we can still tell that you're like so passionate and enthusiastic about our nature. So we really, really appreciate that. So without further ado, let's move on to our first question. And it is coming from Kent. What's the other two species of turtles that can be found here in Malaysia?
There are four. Is the usually the green turtle, and the other, the right, how you call, the rider turtle, yeah? And the leatherback, but the leatherback no more. So the important is in the coastline of Melaka, you have quite huge population of the harvest turtle. So you are a privilege. You are quite privileged. Yes.
Mm. Okay. So may I ask, do they lay eggs on only one spot, only one beach, or do they go elsewhere if this place is reclaimed?
Usually they use all the coastline of the Strait of Malacca to nest, but it's true that usually they prefer settle areas, for example, like the Pulau Upe before, now no more, okay. For the land reclamation, now dropping a lot the number of the nests if you see the data. And then the Pantai Padangke Munting, all this area until Port Dixon, they lie so much because if you realize it's quite big sandy beach, yeah, they are quite huge, so they can go in and lie in the eggs. The problem is humans, we create the roads, and they also we planting trees that they have a roots very long, and then sometimes they create problems to the normal activity of the turtles. And also, for example, at night in these kampung areas, they like to go to fishing at night. Okay, that is okay. But also they may sometimes fire and also leave a lot of the rabbits there. So sometimes when the turtles want to come to lie in the eggs, they see the humans, so they don't want to come out. You know, yes. So they try to find another place and say, okay, here, no, I'm looking for another beach. So we have to, maybe try to protect these sandy beaches, limit the activity at night. You know, it's just, okay, in this beach, yeah, you can come, you can fishing and you do your picnic or whatever. But in this one, better don't do because come the turtles to nest. So just leaving some areas for them. I think, no bad, no? We have already so much, right?
Yes, exactly. We have all the spaces. Okay, moving on to the next question. It's from Mr. Voti. Irrawaddy dolphins are also survive in freshwater? Are they found in freshwater?
The Irrawindis are quite special dolphins. My first time I saw them was in Kuching, in Santubong.
Oh, Kuching, yes.
Yeah, in the natural park Santubong. It's quite nice to see how they collaborate together with the fishermen, and they go inside to the fresh water. Of course, not to the top, but just, I mean, in the mouth of the river, they used to go there.
So can they survive there long term?
Yeah.
They
it's quite interesting to study them, really. It's really nice, yeah. Also because they are super small, so they can, you know, swim against the current sea, and it's very interesting to know about them. So you are so
lucky. It's a privilege. You're so lucky to meet them. Okay, and the next one is from Yok Mui. She's basically saying, spot on, Maria, about not picking up and collecting shells and marine creatures. A little concerned about ethical and responsible responsible intertidal nature walk. Some creatures may be accidentally stepped on by people. Could you please share us some advice on how to do so in safe and responsible ways so that harm to marine creatures, some can be really tiny, including corals, is minimized? Thank you.
Yeah, very interesting. Well, see Raya. Yeah, we just have to understand that when we go on the nature is like a museum, okay? When you go to a museum, you don't touch the picture, right? You don't touch the sculpture, right? Because it's like delicate and it's expensive. Also, if you're broken, you have a big trouble, right? So we have to understand the nature as like this. We just go, we are a visitors, okay? We are a visitors, it's true. In the interzone, you have the opportunity to touch or to have experiment with them. You can take the hermit crab, see, say, ah, hello, and then put in the same way, But don't try to collect, because humans, we have this kind of obsession that we want to possess everything. We want to have everything for us, no? Like, for what? If at the end it's material, it's just material things, right? For that, I always encourage the people to spend their money in experience, not in materials. Because the material, you will forget, but the experience, you keep here, okay? In your mind, in your remember. So it's very beautiful when you, for that I encourage the people also to join Malaysia Nature Society, because they create activities that we can be together, and we create a nice day and like a memory, and we can learn ones to others. So this is also humans, we are a contact species, we need the contact with others. Yes. Okay, we are alone, like happened now in the lockdowns, the people mental health and things affected the mental health, of course, because you don't have contacts, you want to share, okay, and you want to feed your soul with information. So it's important learn once to others and just respect the nature, because even you don't see, there are a universe of life. You, for example, you take yesterday we talking, Ken and me talking about that. You take a liter of sand, the sand on the beach, you put under the microscope, you can flashing. You flashing because you see very, very tiny polychaetes or very tiny animals that look like from other space, like from other planet. Wow.
We should all experience that. We should have like this kind of exhibition or something, or experiment in school, so that they all can see and we can all protect the nature.
It's super, super, super interesting. Even you take just a drop of water, I told you before, it's like an ecosystem, only a drop of water, you can find a lot of the interesting species.
So all the microorganisms.
Just have to open the eyes, go with people that know about this, because sometimes when we go alone, if we don't know, we just cross maybe with when we diving. If nobody tell us, hey, look, this is a coral. If you don't know, you just cross by and you didn't realize. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
It's a colorful rock. But no, when you know, hey, this is a coral, it's like ocean flowers. You go and see and say, wow, so interesting, look. And then you see how they're moving. And so it's very nice.
Okay, thank you, Maria. Next, we have some FB questions. So the first one is, of 14 species of sea grasses in Malaysia, how many found in Malacca?
They say, this is the report that I read, 7 of them are the dominants. Okay, so it's quite... it's quite important, because this is like the schools of the sea, They it's all the little fish, the younger animals there. So if we destroy these, we destroy the future generations. So here, because some people say, Melaka, the Sea of Melaka is dead. No,
yes.
The Sea of Melaka has so much life, but you don't know how to look it. You know what I mean?
Yes,
so the
exactly.
seagrass is true that underwater is a risk, no? Because first is the crocodile, so we can be the food of the crocodile, so you cannot die. And then the second is a lot of the jellyfish, and then the currency, the marine traffic, so also the sedimentation for the land reclamation. So it's difficult to have a good visibility. But if you go a little farther to the coastline, you can see the water so clear. You know the Melaka, the pulaus in front of Melaka, there are a lot of pulaus, right? Yeah. But it looks like the Perhentian water. Yeah, so you have so much things to discover here. But for that, you cannot allow they destroy before you discover it. Because if
yes.
destroys, do a studio, you know? Yeah,
even if we go there, we cannot, we just see and we leave, but we cannot destroy it whilst we're there. Okay, the next one is, do we have whales in Malaysia?
Yeah, got whales in Malaysia. It's true, they're not living here, you know, the whales also do very huge migration. Oh my God, they are a fantastic, magnificent animals. Huh?
Where do you see it?
They just cross the Strait of Malacca. They cross the Strait of Malacca.
So it's hard to actually spot them.
All around. I never see them here. I tell you the truth. I never see whale shark, but no, it's a whale. No, it's a real whale. It's a fish, no? But all the studios that I researched, for that I want to include it in the presentation because it was shocking for me. I also didn't know here got whales and a lot of dolphins, so I want to include it for the people know. For example, in Spain, the research area of marine mammals, we only have 7. So you have 11, you have 11, and 9 of them cross the Malacca Strait.
Oh wow. Yeah, it's actually a very privilege. Moving on to our last question by Harris. Besides reclamation, what other human activity can affect corals? We do have answers coming in from Dr. Zarina. So basically he's talking about ocean acidification. So do you want to elaborate on that or do you have anything to talk about it?
Yeah. About corals, I can talk all the afternoon and the next morning because I love so much. I'm really passionate about corals. It's a species that really cuts my hair because they're super interesting. They are suffering quite a lot for the human activities. The first, we are increasing the ocean temperature. This is a reality, and this the reason is our activity. So, no, increase the CO2, so this increase also the temperature of the water. But this is related with the acidification that Dr. Zarina, that I sent a big, huge kiss from here. She say very well, also affect the acidification. The acidification of the water created because when increase in the atmosphere, the CO2, it is absorbed by the ocean. And then what happened is a chemical reaction. Okay, a chemical reaction in the ocean. So got less opportunity for the coral, that the coral that create the exoskeleton to absorb the carbonato calcicum. So if they don't absorb the carbonato calcicum, they cannot create the structure. Okay. But not only that, also when the water is more acid, also can dissolve exoskeletons can start to dissolve in the water.
The shells of all the snails and stuff like that, right?
Correct.
So it's very important. Yes.
So we have a huge problem for that. We are so annoying, all the scientists say, please, the climatic change, change your habit, because it's a huge problem. But at the moment, don't exist a real volunteer for the governments to, not only Malaysia, I talk all the governments in the world, to change the reality and go for the alternative way. So at the moment we are in this situation, just asking everyone try to change their habit. I encourage you to go to the places and say, no, without plastic straw. No, I have my own bag, okay? Because this is a way that you can, you know, you make a punch to the
be
people.
Be the first to change, and then people will follow suit. Yes, exactly. Next one, it's still from Dr. Zarina Khalid. So she asks, we know about the harmful effects of plastic and microplastic. What about microfiber?
Oh, the microfiber, you know, when I'm talking about the pollution, I say there are plastic, water, land, and air pollution, right? When I say, this is very recently studios that they did, they discovered that in our air, we are introducing ourselves also microfabric, because they are in on the earth, inside the earth. The same like the microplastic in the water, they are microfabric on the air. So we
in
are
the air.
Yeah. So this has started to be a big problem also, because it's stuck in our land. You can see how huge problem is, because the plastic cannot, no, it's digestive, and also if you breathe, they will still there forever.
Yes, exactly.
I mentioned before, got chemicals that they are usually disrupt, endocrine disrupt, so will affect to our body. So it's a big problem. And this microfiber is usually in our clothes.
Oh, it's in our clothes. So what other alternatives do we go after when we are trying to get, when we're trying to get clothes? Is there any alternative?
Just the natural one, like the cotton, because it's the biodegradable. Try to use how you call it in English, lino, bueno, all this kind of texture that create with the natural material, with the the hornbill.
Oh, is that hornbill? Wow.
Yeah, you have to come one day, yeah?
Yeah.
These, all these kind of materials that is created for plants, okay?
So we have to pick for those. All right, the next one is from Kathir Ravan. So what are the economic values of sustaining the lives below water?
Very interesting. All right. We have a lot, but you know the problem, we never monitor inside them. I mean, we never put a price. For that, we don't give value, because no, it's inside our economy. Our economy. If we start to say like all the air, all the oxygen that we breathe costs 500 ring rings a day, you will start to value what the nature made for us, because at the end we are taking by free. We are using
Yes.
A lot of big companies, they become rich because they using free our resource, the resource of our nature. Gas, oil, petrol, all the palm oil plantations, they're using for free our nature. If we start to say, okay, you, the owner of the palm oil plantation, for example, you want to use this land, you have to pay to all the habitants, all the kampungs all the people, the orangs around, you have to pay 500 rinrins a day because it's the you are destroying the air, the oxygen that they usually breathing before. You will start to see how we change the mind. So yeah, they have a value, but we don't put the price. That's the problem.
Yes. So we need more awareness. We need to know that nature costs something. It's not that we're taking it for free for always and it's unlimited.
Yeah.
We really have to cut down and we have to educate people. Yeah, that's a really good one. Okay, I think that is pretty much all about it. So I would like to pass it on back to Linisha. Thank you so much, Maria, for answering all the questions. And yeah, thank you.
Right. Thank you so much, Zoe and Maria, for the very enlightening session. So now it's time for us to announce the quiz winners. Let's see who are the winners. Just a moment. Okay, so let's see. So I'm going to play the drum roll. Okay, so you're going to pick the top five here. So we have Jasmine Ng, Gugalendi, Ashmita, Yovan Raj, and Angelo Amrish. So congratulations to the winners. So you may send your, you may contact the organizer, Ms. Woody, and send your address to receive the gifts, yeah? Okay, so let me go back to my slide. Okay. All right, so, yep. So thank you very much, Maria, for the amazing session. And Maria has given us the opportunity to experience the biodiversity of Malacca through our screens. It was an amazing visual treat. And it was amazing to see how Malacca is not only rich in historical sites, but also rich in biodiversity. And we should all come together and preserve our biodiversity together. So, that's it for today. So the next talk will be on the 16th of October at 2 p.m. So the speaker would be Dr. Kalidasan. And the topic would be life underwater too, how and why we should take care of our rivers. And a big thanks to our volunteers. Thank you so much. You wouldn't have been possible without all of you. So speaker, Maria, thank you so much. Technical support, Woody, co-host Zoe, and quiz master Zoe. Thank you so much. We'll meet again in our next session. Yeah, thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you too.
Thank you.
Bye,
Lisha. Bye. Is this the end? Okay, we are supposed to leave, is it?
Yeah, I think so.